इसका ऐसा है देखो, खून मांगो खून देंगे, अपना नारा है, खून मांगो खून मांगेंगे तो खून देंगे, एक कश्मीर मांगोगे तो भून देंगे, ये हमारा मतलब है। कश्मीर अगर मांगेगा कोई भी तो उसको भून दिया जाएगा, ये हमारा मतलब है। इसका अर्थ हुआ, और खून मांगेगा हम तो खून दे देंगे, जान दे देंगे, और कश्मीर मांगोगे तो हम भून देंगे पाकिस्तान को, क्या किसी को भी, चाहे अमेरिका हो चाहे कोई भी हो।
A new generation of Pakistanis and Indians is stepping forward to claim Kashmir. Driven by nationalistic and religious fervor, they, like their parents and grandparents before them, think that their side can win in this ever more bloody and violent contest. Trapped in the middle are the diverse peoples of Jammu and Kashmir. They have their own histories and their own dreams. Each side points to the violence and injustice of the other. Each side feels only the suffering and the sorrow and pain of their own. Now, in seeking to understand a conflict which is as bloody as this, one that has consumed nearly 100,000 lives and caused incalculable human suffering, is it at all possible for one to be non-partisan, objective and fair? Can one set aside the preconceptions and prejudices that one is inevitably born into? Now, I don't know whether this question can be answered in the affirmative or not. It is admittedly a very theoretical one. But surely it is of the greatest importance to let facts speak for themselves as we begin our journey towards the heart of one of the world's most intractable conflicts. The road to understanding leads inevitably to the city of Srinagar, the heart of Indian-ruled Kashmir. It is home to diverse peoples who have lived on this land for hundreds of years. Across the land, the population is divided unevenly, with the Muslims being the overwhelming majority in the Kashmir Valley. The total population of Muslims, Hindus and Buddhists is approximately 10 million. The Muslim majority has traditionally been poorly educated. It held little economic or political power. Hindu pundits are a minority in the Kashmir Valley, but they belong to a relatively privileged economic and social class.
It is the pundits who are the literate, it is the pundits who are the always in the managerial classes, it is the pundits who are the officers of the courts. They are known as the Karkun pundits. Pundits learned Farsi, pundits learned Urdu. They were the teachers, they were the, you know, amis, they were the... Now, under the Hindu monarchy, which was established by Gulab Singh, the pundits prospered. Now, even in 1990, when we did the study, this is 50 years down the line from 1947, when we did this study, we found 86% of the state government jobs at the governance, at the gazetted level, you know, grade 1, grade 2 and grade 3, were all manned by pundits. I do not know whether it is a conscious policy of the Indian state to promote only Hindus or pundits, but the fact is that it is the pundits who control.
Resentment against pundit domination and Indian control fueled Kashmiri demands for self-rule and democracy.
Pura Kashmir azadi chahta hai. Kyunki azadi hamara haq hai. Hum pehle bhi azad the aur ab bhi chahte hain. Agar aap kehte hain ki hum yahan ke log Hindustan ke saath hain, to phir kar lo election.
For decades, Kashmiris tried to effect change under the Indian constitution and through the ballot box, but they were frustrated. And in 1987, matters finally came to a head.
Hum us waqt tak bhi mere dil mein, dil ke kisi khane mein, ye yakeen kisi ne kisi darje mein maujood tha, India jaise democratic setup mein, अगर पीसफुली कोई बात रखी जाए और एक आइन तरीक़ेकार से लोगों की कुव्वत को अपने हक में मोबालाइज किया जाए तो वो फैसला कुन साबित हो सकता है। लेकिन 87 में जो मासिकल रिगिंग हो गई, जो कैंडिडेट्स को काउंटिंग हॉल से गिरफ्तार करके पाबंद सलासल किया गया, जो बैलेट बॉक्सेस को डिस्ट्रॉय करके नए बैलेट बॉक्स लाए गए और ख़ुद बरद भी दिए गए, नतज भी ऐलान किया गया, तो उस वक्त भारत के नाम नहाद जमहूरियत पर हमारा सारा जो कॉन्फिडेंस था कुल्ली तौर शेक हो गया।
The elections were a turning point in Kashmir's history. Police, paramilitary and armed forces from all over India were sent in to prop up the newly installed state government. Many viewed it as illegitimate and corrupt, and the security forces as an army of occupation sent in to suppress the people's voice. For the first time, the demand for secession from India gained mass support. As people took to the streets, a deadly cycle of protest and repression was unleashed.
मैंने कहा हम हमेशा आज़ादी की जो लड़ाई लड़ रहे थे या राइट ऑफ सेल्फ डिटर्मिनेशन की लड़ाई लड़ रहे थे, जिस पे मैंने खुद भी तकरीबन इस मिलिटेंस से पहले 16-17 साल जेल काटे थे, तो मैंने कभी कोई पत्थर तक भी नहीं उठाया था। और हम जब आज़ादी की बात या इस मसले को हल करने की बात करते थे तो हमें गोली और गालियों से नवाजा करते थे। शायद यहाँ के जवानों ने इस चीज़ को कबूल नहीं किया, तो उन्होंने कहा कि हम इस मसले को इंटरनेशनल एजेंडा पे लाने के लिए कोई ऐसा काम कर पाए जिससे कश्मीर की तरफ दुनिया भर की तवज्जो मरकूज हो जाए।
As young Kashmiri militants took up arms, Indian forces responded with ever greater force. Many Kashmiris fled their homes into neighboring Pakistani-controlled Kashmir. For most, there was little choice.
Na sandi utha khena da, na lena da, na bar nikle achar mar chhod da. Bas, aur utha kadi nahi mushkil. Mushkil na hove assi apna ground chhod de.
Such displacement increased Kashmiri determination to resist Indian rule and seek support from Pakistan.
Every Kashmiri want to fight, want to that India should withdraw from Kashmir. This is the only aim, our aim, and we want that the superpowers, the super countries should bear down on India, so that India should withdraw her forces from Kashmir territory, because Kashmir is only for Kashmiris, and the Kashmiris have right to live there.
Pakistan's army saw opportunity in the struggle and suffering of Kashmiris. Its intervention was soon to change the hitherto secular character of the Kashmiri movement. The strategy now was to wage war by proxy. It was designed as a low-cost way to win Kashmir by bleeding India. Working with radical Islamic groups in bases inside Pakistani Kashmir, the army used its secret intelligence agencies to recruit, train and arm holy warriors. The jihadis came from all over the Muslim world. Many were already battle-hardened.
The training of Kashmir militants was the direct consequence of the experience gained while recruiting the young people for Afghanistan. And not only that, the experience was gained, but physical transfer of personnel was also possible, that those who fought in Afghanistan could also fight in Kashmir. And the madrasas became the first centers of recruitment. General Ziaul Haq allowed land, credit facilities, cash resources for the establishment of huge religious seminaries. These seminaries became popular because they provided shelter to a large number of young, poor people. They got food, they got scholarship, and they also got promise of a place in paradise.
Allah says us to fight with India because the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam promised with us the two groups of the Muslims. They will be liberated from hell. The one that will fight against India, the second that who will fight with the Christ against the infidels. Because this is the cause of Islam. The Islam is not surrounded by a territory, not from Pakistan, not in the Kashmir. Islam is a religion of globe. So the people, I think that the people from all over the world, they should come to Kashmir and they should fight with us.
Many did indeed go to fight. Some returned as heroes.
ये तो अल्लाह के शेरों और मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम के गुलामों का काफला है जो इंशाल्लाह बढ़ता ही चला जाएगा और हम इंशाल्लाह दिल्ली के लाल किले पे पाकिस्तानी परचम लहराने का अजम रखते हैं इंशाल्लाह उसे पूरा करके दिखाएंगे.
The Kashmir struggle became identified with jihad. In towns and cities across the country, rich and poor alike contributed money to armed radical Islamic groups and their fighters. Encouraged by the state, thousands rallied to the cause.
For us, these deaths are not deaths, because Allah says, "Wala taqulu liman yuqtalu fi sabilillahi amwat, bala hayyun wala kulla tashurun." So when we die, we say we embrace shahadat. When those people die, when army is killed by us, so they think that they have been destroyed. They think death means decay and decomposition. So for us, it is jihad, and it will continue till our until we gain our goal.
The jihad has had tragic consequences for Kashmir's minorities. Fleeing years of violence and growing tensions with the majority Muslim population, many Hindu pundits sought safety in Jammu and elsewhere. Like the Muslims who had fled to the Pakistani part of Kashmir, they too carried a heavy burden of sorrow.
मेरे दो बच्चे थे, एक लड़का एक लड़की, भाग कर आए मैं. वहाँ पर हमारी गेट था, गेट के सामने एक घर था, घर में एक गोली बजी, उसको एक छाती से यहाँ निकल गई एक कश्मीरी पंडित को. फिर हमने पता नहीं ट्रक में किसने लगाए, कहाँ से आए, पहुँच गए हम गीताबा.
On one side, we were a very insignificant social group with very little political stakes for the political establishment of the country, irrelevant for them. And on the other side, we were the front line for the Islamic fundamentalist forces, because they visualized us as a Hindu element, as an element of historical continuity, civilizational continuity, as an element which imparts a democratic plural texture to the society. So in this situation, an atmosphere of siege and absolute insecurity built up, and once it was complemented with this select kill one and secure 100, it created a very entirely a different situation.
The innocents became targets, and massacre followed massacre.
Thank you.
मैंने कहा जिनने भी जो इबादत गाहों पर पूजा करने पे लोगों जो पूजा के हवाले से मंदिरों में जाते हैं मस्जिदों में जाते हैं उनको मारते हैं वो फ्रीडम फाइटर्स हो नहीं सकते दे आर किलर किलर इज किलर
Some Hindu pandits continue to live in the Kashmir Valley. Families and communities try to keep alive their culture and traditions. But they are a people under siege and need protection from the violence around them. Not all pandits have given up the hope of a peaceful future. Others have been scarred by their suffering. They seek to settle scores with Pakistan.
देखो जे पाकिस्तान और इंडिया जो है जे तो एक मात्र जो है जैसे राम का युद्ध हुआ था तो उस वक्त सीता माता की वजह से युद्ध हुआ था तो इस वक्त हमारी जो सीता माता हमारे लिए कश्मीर है पार्टी चाहे कोई भी हो चाहे बीजेपी हो चाहे कांग्रेस हो चाहे समता पार्टी कोई भी आएगी युद्ध के बिना ये सोल्यूशन नहीं निकलेगा ये तो मेरा व्यक्तिगत विचार है युद्ध के बाद ऐसा होगा कि पाकिस्तान का नामो निशान मिट जाएगा
The Kashmir dispute and the role of radical Islam have fueled a bitter battle within India. Militant Hindu organizations such as the Vishwa Hindu Parishad and the Bharatiya Janata Party are challenging a long-standing tradition of secular nationalism. Politicians have joined religious leaders in dreaming of a greater Hindu India. They search for power by offering to make war against Islam and Pakistan.
आज पूरे भारत को इस्लामिक जेहादी आतंकवाद ने आतंकित किया और दुर्भाग्य से उनको समर्थन देने वाला पाकिस्तान नाम का एक आतंकवादी राष्ट्र दुनिया के नक्शे पर मौजूद है जब तक पाकिस्तान का अस्तित्व दुश्मन के नक्शे में से मिट नहीं जाता है लाहौर और रावलपिंडी इस्लामाबाद भारत का हिस्सा नहीं बन जाता है भाइयों तब तक के दरिंदे तालिबान जे हाथी तुम्हें शांति से जीने नहीं देंगे क्या यही चाहते हो कि कश्मीर घाटी में हिंदुओं के साथ तुमने जो व्यवहार किया वो भारत के 6 लाख गांव में तुम्हारे साथ किया जाए
India is being transformed by the radical Hindu nationalist politics of the BJP and its partners. Like other fundamentalists across South Asia, their goal is to purge society of its cultural and religious diversity. As this noisy crowd passes through a Muslim neighborhood, of riot-torn Gujarat, it hurls abuse and provocation. But there is a quieter, more insidious transformation occurring in much of India. A new and different generation of Indians is coming of age.
The major change that has taken place since the BJP came to power and took power at the central government was that the curriculum, the books, the history book has changed. They're missing, they're just deleting portions after portions of history, which would tell them that yes, the historically or culturally, what was the influence of Islam in the region. So that portion is completely missing. They're trying to emphasize on the Hindu kingdoms, what has been happening after that. Mughals are touched upon, but not really looked at it, what has been their cultural contribution, architectural contribution, contribution to the basic psyche of growing up and, you know, the India coming along.
In Pakistan, children have been subjected to a similar assault by successive governments for decades.
Allah Akbar! 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 हम जंग लड़ते रहेंगे और इंडिया को बताएंगे कि पाकिस्तान का बच्चा बच्चा इसकी खातिर लड़ेगा और अपने खून रक्त बहा देंगे.
Education in Pakistan these days is the means of indoctrination through which the state propagates its ideology. This was not always so. The earlier times were much better times. In my childhood, we learned history, geography, and several other disciplines, old history, new history. But these days, all of those things are being put in the straitjacket of indoctrination. Let me quote you from a book over here. This is a book on Urdu, class 8. The book says over here, some quoting somebody, that come what may, a Hindu can never be a well-wisher of Muslims.
Prejudice against the other is rooted in the poison soil of partition. In 1947, a new nation had been created on the basis of religious identity. In the frenzy that followed, a million people, Muslims, Hindus, and Sikhs, died as they fled their native lands. Neighbor turned against neighbor. The tidal wave of religious hatred carried people away from their homes into new and unfamiliar territories. The Punjab saw major atrocities. Kashmir was luckier. But Maharaja Hari Singh was an autocratic Hindu ruler despised by the impoverished Muslim majority of Kashmir. A Muslim leader, Sheikh Abdullah, led the movement for democracy and reform. He became immensely popular. He shared secular ideals with Jawaharlal Nehru, a Kashmiri pundit who became the first Prime Minister of India. Neither wanted Kashmir to cede to Pakistan. But Muhammad Ali Jinnah, the founder of Pakistan, wanted Muslim-majority states to become Pakistan.
We must remember that we have to take momentous decisions and handle grave issues facing us in the solution of the complex political problem of this great subcontinent inhabited by 400 million people.
Jinnah argued that the new nation would be incomplete without Kashmir. He said that the K in Pakistan stood for Kashmir. Lord Mountbatten, the last British viceroy, showed little resolve in mediating the dispute. He was more concerned with assuring Britain's graceful exit from India. But this was not to be so.
Pathan tribesmen and Pakistan Army regulars invaded Kashmir in 1947.
Indian troops were flown into Srinagar on Nehru's orders. The bitter fighting ended in a stalemate with a temporary ceasefire line separating the two armies. In 1953, Nehru delivered a speech wherein he agreed to a plebiscite in Kashmir.
Our pledge to the people of Kashmir, if you like, the people of this world, that this matter could be affirmed or cancelled by the people of Kashmir according to their wishes. We do not wish to win people against their will with the help of armed force. And if the people want to part company with us, they may go their own way and we shall go ours. We want no forced marriages, no forced unions.
But there was no plebiscite, and the ceasefire line effectively remained the border. It sliced Kashmir into two, passing over hills and through valleys. Frequent clashes across this line increased tensions. Their effects were felt everywhere, including the southern border. New disputes constantly arose. In 1965, India and Pakistan went to war over Kashmir.
We started the thing by moving into Indian-occupied Kashmir, and I was commander of the Air Force till only 6 weeks before that. I had no idea they were doing this, and when I saw in the newspapers that our tanks were moving into Indian-occupied Kashmir, I saw Ayub Khan on the 3rd of September, 3 days before the Indians attacked, and I said to him that I think you've decided to go to war, He said, no, not at all. Who told you that? I said, nobody told me, but reading the newspapers, you send the army into occupied Kashmir, therefore India is bound to react, and they will react in the Punjab. He said, no, not at all. This will not happen. We've been assured by the Foreign Office this is not likely to happen. So it'll be localized conflict. And of course, on the 6th of September, 3 days later, Indian forces moved into Pakistan. We suffered casualties, and the Indians did too. But the net result was not much. I mean, we didn't win the war, nor did the Indians. The Air Force did very well indeed. In the first 4 days, we'd almost knocked the Indian Air Force out. They were not able to fly over Pakistan.
Although both countries claimed victory, in fact, the war inflicted approximately equal losses upon both. A settlement was soon negotiated in the city of Tashkent. But Pakistan was militarily defeated in 1971, and the war left it split into two. The following year, the prime ministers of India and Pakistan met at Shimla to discuss Kashmir. They agreed to obey the United Nations Charter and resolve the dispute peacefully, as well as respect the 1948 Kashmir ceasefire line. Renamed as the Line of Control, it separates the armies of India and Pakistan even today. Both countries refuse to accept it as the international border, and both accuse the other of violating the Shimla Accord. The constant shelling took a terrible toll in life and property. In the far northern reaches of Kashmir, the line of control has not been demarcated. Since 1984, India and Pakistan have been locked in bitter combat over the Siachen Glacier. But nature has mocked the ambitions of both armies. Altitude sickness and frostbite have claimed more casualties than enemy artillery.
It happens at a certain height, differs from body to body, temperament to temperament. And suddenly man collapses. For example, he's going to a forward post. It reaches at 15,000, 16,000 and he collapses.
The ultimate weapon at hand, they believed they had finally found the means to confront India.
28 May ke tarikh saas din ke baad ye meri aap se pehli mulaqat hai. Mujhe yakeen hai ki chaghi ke pahadon ki garmi Siachen ki barf posh chotiyon tak zarur pahunchi hogi. और जिस तरह एटमी धमाकों ने पाकिस्तानी कौम को नया हौसला और बलबला दिया है इसी तरह आपकी कुव्वत ईमानी और जोश व जज्बे में भी इजाफा हुआ होगा
द बॉम्ब ब्रॉट न्यूक्लियर नेशनलिज्म एंड द बैलिस्टिक मिसाइल आर्म्ड विद अ न्यूक्लियर वेपन द मिसाइल्स कुड फ्लाई अक्रॉस द बॉर्डर एंड डिस्ट्रॉय अ सिटी इन लेस देन 5 मिनट्स दे कुड नॉट बी स्टॉप्ड From now on, land and people in India and Pakistan were condemned to live in the shadow of the bomb just moments away from catastrophe. The missiles became the new symbols of military power. Pakistan built missile monuments across the country in public places. From Karachi to Kashmir, they held out the promise of war and the illusion of victory. The country's leadership came to believe in this, as did the rank and file in the army.
Allah Akbar! Allah Akbar! Allah Akbar! Pakistan!
The confidence of a nuclear umbrella led to a secret incursion by Pakistan's army and the Mujahideen in the Kargil area of Kashmir. The Indians were taken by surprise, and Pakistan's leadership was euphoric after some easy victories.
मेरे बहादुर जवानों, कारगिल की चोटियों पर मुजाहिदीन आजादी का कब्जा उनकी 11 साल जंगी आजादी का सिला है.
According to ZTV again today, one regiment of the Indian Army called the Rajputana Rifles has buried, according to their own television, 130 dead. A battalion is normally about 800 men. There are 27 battalions that the Indians have used in this area against the Mujahideen, and let me add, at 14 different occasions against the Pakistan Army on the line of control.
India's attempt to use air power failed, and two Indian fighter aircraft crashed on the Pakistani side. Fear of nuclear weapons prevented it from widening the war.
I am taking no chances, and I would like to say as the Chief of Army Staff that we are prepared for the worst, and they should have no wrong notions on that, absolutely.
As the initial surprise wore off, Indian forces poured into Kargil, and a bitter struggle began for the control of the mountain peaks overlooking the road from Srinagar to Leh. The success of the counterattacks and immense international pressure upon Pakistan eventually forced it to withdraw. The humiliation was obvious, but Nawaz Sharif's government put on a brave face.
The Defence Committee of the Cabinet and the Cabinet have already paid growing tributes to the valour and courage of the Mujahideen. Their sacrifices have once again brought Kashmir to the centre stage of the world agenda as an issue with grave implications for regional and global peace.
People are quite pleased with the fact that this is an accomplishment for Pakistan and for Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif. Kashmir issue has been internationalized in a manner it was never done before. A war seems to have been averted, and frankly, on the ground, the Indian Army has got a hammering at the hands of the Mujahideen, which they didn't get since 1962 in the Sino-Indian War.
But the public was unconvinced. Many felt betrayed by Nawaz Sharif's government after having claimed victory after victory. There were angry denunciations of President Bill Clinton and the United States for helping mediate the withdrawal from Kargil. As Islamic fervor reached new heights, religious leaders demanded that Nawaz Sharif step down. Nawaz Sharif's fate was sealed. His removal was just some weeks away.
Today I have taken over as the President of Pakistan through an amendment in a clause of the PCO of 14 October 1999, which allowed continuity to the ex-president of Pakistan. I have been thinking about this change since a number of months. May I say that this has been one of the most difficult decisions in my entire career. I have never done anything for my own self.
In December 2001, India's parliament in Delhi was attacked by armed militants in broad daylight. 12 people, including all 5 attackers, were killed in the fierce gun battle in the heart of the nation's capital. A Pakistan-based group initially took credit for the attack. A massive mobilization of forces followed as India sent its army to the border. Pakistan saw this as an attempt at intimidation. As a million or so soldiers faced each other, catastrophe was only a small misjudgment away. An implicit threat of nuclear weapons was ever present. It was to become the year of living dangerously
and it seemed to last forever. Some Kashmiris said that the armed actions of radical Islamic groups had hurt their cause.
ये कहते हैं जिहाद के नाम दूसरे दिन उठाकर लाल किले पर कब्जा करो इंडिया के टुकड़े कराओ जब तक हम नहीं बैठेंगे जिस वक्त तक इंडिया बर्बाद नहीं होता है इस किस्म के नारे जो हैं ठीक है आपका एक ज़हनी आयशी होती है लेकिन दे आर नॉट प्रैक्टिकेबल हमारा अच्छा खासा सीधा सादा एक मसला कश्मीर था किसी में दुनिया की किसी की ताकत में हिम्मत नहीं हुई थी इसको टेररिस्ट करा देने की हमारे नाम निहाद मुजाहिदों ने जाकर पहले कश्मीर असम्बली पर हमला किया 38 आदमी कश्मीरी मारे गए फिर इंडियन पार्लियामेंट पर किया तो यही इशू जो कल तक सारी दुनिया हमें डायरेक्टली प्रैक्टिकली नहीं करते थे लेकिन ज़बानी ज़बानी हमें सपोर्ट करते थे उनको राइट ऑफ सर्वाइवल मिलना चाहिए इस किस्म की एक्टिविटीज़ की वजह से आज सारी दुनिया कहती है कि ये टेररिस्ट एक्टिविटी है
Repairing the damage done by the attack on the parliament was to take another 12 months and another gathering of South Asian leaders. At a meeting in Islamabad, India and Pakistan finally agreed to resume a dialogue. Once again, there was hope for a Kashmir solution as General Musharraf promised to renounce armed jihad and control the madrasas. But his new position was not welcomed by all in Pakistan. Some saw this as part of a much wider conspiracy against Islam itself.
اس وقت یہ ہے کہ پورا عالم اسلام ایک امتحان میں ہے اور اسلام دشمن ساری قوتیں ایک ہو گئی ہیں یعنی مطلب ہے کہ اس وقت ہزار اختلافات کے باوجود بھی غیر مسلم قوتیں آپس میں اختلافات چھوڑ کر ایک ہو گئیں یعنی روس اور امریکہ ایک ہو گیا ہماری دشمنی میں بھارت اور چین اور یورپی یونین اور سب ایک ہو گئے ہیں ایک اس کو عالمی کولیشن کہتے ہیں جو عالم کفر کا عالمی کولیشن ہے مذہب ہمارا اس طرح خطرے میں ہے کہ اب وہ جب چاہتے ہیں تو دینی مدارس کے خلاف ایک طوفان اٹھتا ہے کہ ان کو بند کیا جائے جہادی تنظیمیں ساری ختم کر دی گئیں داڑھی ایک گالی بنا دی گئی جہاں داڑھی اور پگڑی ہے تو یہ دہشت گرد قرآن مجید میں جہاں اہم آیات ہیں مسلمانوں کو زندہ رہنے کے طریقے سکھائے گئے ہیں بچاؤ اور دفاع کا طریقہ سکھایا گیا ہے یہاں تک کہا گیا ہے کہ ان آیات کو بھی قرآن مجید سے نکالا جائے
Peace in Kashmir has many enemies, not just religious extremists. These include the two militaries. For 50 years, the Pakistan military has nurtured fear of war. It is a powerful economic force with much to lose.
The foremost way in which the military has expanded its sphere of influence all over civil society in Pakistan and the private sector really is through the operation of its private foundations. Which are namely the AWT, the Shaheen, the Beharia, and the largest corporation in the country, which is the Fauji Foundation. These foundations not just take away liquidity from the private sector, they also take away key contracts from the private sector. They operate their own operations. They are not usually open, their operations are not open to scrutiny, nor to public tenders. They are above, as I said, accountability. We don't know how they run their pensions or their budgets or anything. But we also now see again what I call the khakiization of Pakistan through key appointments and key public sector posts, which would have gone to civilians traditionally, but now are manned by either generals or retired generals. And other men in uniform, whether they are qualified to hold those jobs or not.
The military is also a central pillar of the Indian state. Its armed forces have been used over and over again to crush the many secessionist movements that have arisen since independence. Fearing the unmet demands of its diverse peoples, India has sought to project itself as a strong state. Today, India seeks to project power over its neighbors. Nuclear weapons and ballistic missiles have become part of its arsenal. The search for a negotiated settlement to Kashmir is made difficult by the temptation to resolve the issue through the use of force. In the India justifies building up its military strength and its military actions by claiming that it is an embattled secular democracy. But not all Indians agree.
While India formally remains a secular democracy, while formally people are treated as one, I mean, and citizenship rights are given to everybody, and there is no, ostensibly no discrimination made, the reality is very different. The reality is very different for minorities in India. The reality is very different for people who are living in conflict zones where internal wars are going on, be it Kashmir or parts of Northeast. And that reality is that they are actually denied even the most, you know, basic fundamental civic liberties. In these areas, which are declared as disturbed, you actually lose your right to life.
We have seen how complicated Kashmir has become. National chauvinism, territorial ambition, and religious fanaticism have soaked the land in blood. So is there a solution? And what could it possibly be? Kashmiris, Pakistanis, and Indians have ready answers, answers that they're willing to kill and die for. Many territorial divisions of Kashmir have been proposed, but all are problematic.
India formally claims all of Kashmir, but this inseparable part would have to be held in place by force of arms. It would be a giant prison where Indian nationalism could fulfill its fantasy. The strife in Kashmir would continue unabated. Pakistan too has long dreamed of having Kashmir. It considers Kashmir as the unfinished business of partition. But the tragedy of East Pakistan proved that Islam is not enough to bind disparate people into a nation. Many Kashmiris dream of a united, independent Kashmir, even though it has been rejected by both India and Pakistan. But independence is not necessarily the same as freedom, particularly if Kashmir becomes an Islamic state. The Hindus and Sikhs of Jammu and the Buddhists of Ladakh would then become second-class citizens in their own land. Independence for just the Muslim-majority valley has also been proposed. But then Kashmiris would end up divided between three states. Those who chose the valley would be cut off from the world. It would be a nation without resources or a future. The impossibility of changing borders by military means leaves only the status quo. Some activists think that the Kashmiri quagmire demands radical new ideas.
When we talk about whether Kashmiris should be part of India or part of Pakistan or independent, we are trying to find solutions which are exclusive, which are exclusive or partial either towards India or Pakistan or towards Kashmiris. Now Kashmir, ultimately, it is situated in a region which is called South Asia, and South Asian region is moving inevitably towards a closer cooperation and maybe towards a free trade area and eventually maybe towards the South Asian economic community. So if Kashmir has to remain where it is, then I think we need to think about the South Asian solution to Kashmir. And that is where I think Kashmir becomes a kind of a bridge between India and Pakistan, rather than remaining as a bone of contention or a territory which divides them.
Kashmir's expanding graveyards are proof of the futility of violence. History has given us a difficult problem that is not of anyone's choosing. We cannot afford to remain prisoners of the past and to repeat costly mistakes. Does the answer to Kashmir lie in yet a new map and a new border? Or does it lie in how we choose to live together? The young and the innocent shall face the consequences of our generation's decisions. Time alone shall tell whether we had the wisdom, the compassion, and the courage to cherish our differences and to dream new dreams.